Hi, everybody. I want to welcome you, first of all, to the 3rd Annual Filipino Studies Conference at UCLA. And the Art Path to Follow poetry reading featuring Jessica Hagedorn and Al Robles. And the Art Path to Follow poets. My name is Don Mabalon, and this is Wendell Powell, and we're from the Art Path to Follow Collective.
First of all, I'd like to thank everybody who made it possible for us to be gathered this evening, because it's, there's a lot of spirits, good spirits guiding our way, and we have a night, a special night for everybody. This series started about 3 years ago, and it started the art gallery, and this is going to be the last under the name Our Path to Follow, because we're going to try to move on and try to create an anthology so that we broaden the base, beyond our community, because we feel that there's a lot of people that deserve to be heard. And reading is dedicated especially to one of our, I guess, brothers or, fellow writers and expressionists, Jose Garcia Villa. He just passed away in February, and he's watching over us today. And if you notice the program, there's a dove and a lion. And Dove Big Lion was one of his, pen names when he wrote in English, because he was, I guess, not exiled, but he left the Philippines because he wrote erotica. And, the government, tripped out on that. So we're here to honor him and to commemorate, the conference and this gathering. Someone very special to me once said that our connection is of the mind, not of the body. Intellectual intimacy. To see with clarity regarding my and I identity. My identity is masked over a volume of impacted momentum. Checking myself at least once a day, like Centrum. From A to Zinc, I think I'm all of the above. A quarter from Egypt, 75 from the islands, my reveals the past. All leading to a natural state of likeness. One blood, sang adara, justiagmina. My love for my body, the machine. The creator is grateful that I'm able to realize and notice. Distortion of roots causes static. Remind colonized minds to fight systematic. Automatic gear shift. Holding misogyny exists of days when priests were praised by a grave. Blood-stained grass, fighting for land, mass, the upper class. Pistol-minded pagan named Gabriella, never Megan, fuck Megan. For soil watered by tears, retaliation only by way of spears. Smears memories of weary soldiers, died, benefits denied, fighting spirits desired. From streetcars to jeeps, leaping from naval bases, landing into chimneys, keys unlocked, doors to see. Revolution has begun. Words from the A race of the sunbeam. My dream, never going for the cream. I just come in and fire, and I realize that the drumbeat, like my heartbeat next to yours, creating rhythmic infatuation at the point of transgression. Lessons learned, meditation. Liberated levels, digging. Boom, boom. Boom, clap. I thought so. Travel connections of puzzle pieces like Pangea or original continents with intent to win. Hey, I must testify, you kind of fly. Not like Wright brothers, but brother Wright, Widja, my sister's soulmate. Separated only by sectarian borders of cultural, colonial, cock up phony. Not me. True, like the air we breathe together.
Resistance and struggle are sisters. Bulusan said, if you want to know who we are revolution. Vinoska Roska said, never be afraid to do things on your own, in your own way.
If you want to know who this Pina is, she is resistance.
You want to know who this Pina is, she is struggle.
Walking forward into a storm, born in displacement meant
we had born into a life of hardship, each day of war, our bodies are the battlefields, our souls are soldiers, our lives of struggle.
Capitalist, racist, ageist, sexist, it is rape culture, and we must exist.
Colonialism taking our land, but not our souls, and we must struggle.
Lola, Inai, sister, daughter, babae, baybaylan, mom.
Inai, she is resistance.
Auntie, nana, tita, mama, she is Inai, she is struggle. Resistance. Through wars, we have led the struggle on many levels. Guns across our souls, shields protecting our minds, fighting to maintain our culture in an insane rape of our motherland.
Struggle. They came swinging Colt 45 to kill and burn, to turn our homeland into a firestorm. In its eye, we held our families close with strong brown arms. We have known starvation and disease, sexual enslavement and devastation of death. And still we survive.
Resistance. Through diasporic transplantation, contracted by America to move from nation to nation, being stationed in sweatshops to sex brothels, seen only as a maid, bodies laid, dignity torn, hearts and dreams broken, so many words spoken, yet we seem to survive.
Struggle is a love so deep to leave the comfort of a motherland she birthed to America, Saudi, Japan, to can peaches, to pick asparagus, to chop cotton, to care for white babies, to clean the homes of the oppressors. Can you see something? Her hands bleed as she feeds a Filipino nation.
Resistance. Through Pinoy colonization, looking for someone who's down, because we're not willing to take the Pinoy's excuses about why he erases the Pinoy struggle from his own. And we demand that even you, Pinoy man, take a stand and give us a hand. Because this hand is the hand that gave birth to your existence.
Struggle against colonized brown minds to create our lives and self-determination. Being who or what we want to be by our own uncle, father, doula, father, cousin, boyfriend, and even by ourselves. Our aspirations left at the door, our ambitions in the sink, or in the laundry. Silence into a culture of complacency. Ask us what we hold inside, and our dreams are a destiny roar.
Resistance to the neglect of my mom and your mom too. Heroines with stories written about many people spitting on their souls, even their own. Disrespected and rejected by his story, not even seen as political. But step back and check out her way, because if you stop, you'll be seeing and how being Filipino has really saved a life.
Struggle to be recognized, because without us, there would be no Filipino heroes, so check that with your history book. Original world, priestesses and art, forgotten by our own historians. Lola is our queen. Her everyday struggle makes her a heroine, and Ellie says stronger than Eve she is. Kenai, who marches and toils, feeds and clothes. Kenai, in the trenches of war, past, present, and future.
Anyway, Nino Karoska said, what did she say?
Never be afraid to do things on your in your own way.
So yeah, Bulusan was right. If you want to know who we are revolution. But if you want to know who the Pinay is, she is resistance.
If you want to know who the Pinay is, she is struggle.
I'm going to read something that you guys might have heard, but I hope it sounds as original as when I first heard it. It's called Double Speak.
Yeah. Speak. Double, double, speak, speak. All truths are self-evident. Solely from the mouths of malevolent, misguided masters, thus is speaking. About freedom and justice for all who have capital. Economic aid to other countries, the actual meaning of which is that the country of the best manifest destinies of so-called enemies. The third in the race becomes first for dividends. Raw materials become high-priced miracles in the end. Wars of benevolence are really wars of aggression. Imperialism, Philippines 2000, is never questioned. Agents of confusion hide the ill intrusion. They're preaching about the American dream while they're abusing, perusing through the global supermarket. Discontent with the disarray of the world, not mentioning that they started it. In the give-and-take game, it's all take continuously. Sweatshop celebrities, third world commodities. The label on your shirt is sewn by a person who ain't able to describe the amount of hurt that she faces alone. And we're prone to accept allegiance to a flag that's kept. 99.9% of non-whites in disrespect, teaching us to place our hands over our hearts to hide the pain. While we're drenched with gallons of propaganda to wash the brain, the citizen within its apparatus. You know what that means? That means you must be colonized in order to achieve social status. That is not what I perpetuate. Only goal is to liberate, emancipate relations, not claiming false proclamations. Oppressions located within the foundations of a psyche, a brain mundane obsessed with brand names like Gap or Nike. It's time that we revitalize our minds with innovations closer to our creationary state and not to mainstream interpretations of our fate. Wait, we've got to realize we're not the ones we should despise because our eyes don't see the lies, mentalities internalized. So in the end, we've got to send a message to the meek. We've got to seek the true truth behind the double speak. Thank you.
Okay, I don't know, for those of you who don't know me, I'm always, my personality tends to be really strong and dominating, and so this poem is kind of like my acknowledgement of my weak side, and in this I found strength, so I'd just like to share this little ditty with you. It's called In My Solitude. In my solitude, I built around my shrine for other people's crimes when they are deserving. Their haunting guilt will not set them free. So instead, they pass it off to me, the strong one. With a machine gun mouth, using me as a weapon, then wince in reprehension at the bomb, not at the bomber. I am their shield in battle, taking the hit, while they talk shit behind me, saying I'm too strong. It is easy to blame me, I am already hated, so that others can stay objective. Then when I scream from anguish, they reply not with gratitude, but with an attitude of apathy, separated, distancing themselves, staring at me with fear, intimidated by the monster they created when they couldn't bear their own pain. They recoil at the ugliness in my eyes and in my words, too unpleasant to be around, too intense, always on the offense, too loud to hear that what I'm actually expressing is their suffering, their fear, their anger wrapped up in mine. So those who martyr me are those who keep me locked up, chained down, carrying their burden, only visiting me when they need to add 100 more years to my sentence. In my solitude, in my cell of despair, I await my liberation at the dawn of a life which is mine. Thank you.
Fillmore Street. Dark nights of blues, blues and the blues in your eyes, in the blues of syncopated dreams and rhythms, and I love your whispering blues, the blue mirror in your eyes, and the winter cool blues that twist around your mind in the cold night. I love your early morning rain blues and your tight black-brown blues. And I love the foggy Fillmore Street blues that wraps around your mind. I love your daddy blues. I love your mama done told me blues. I love your sister and your brother blues. I love your sweet black brown sugar blues. Cause I got the blues. I got the blues in the night. I got the blues in the night.
Jazz of my youth. gray sharkskin overcoat, the brown gleaming skin of brown Filipino from Stockton. Dark shades, brown fingers running up and down the keys. Dark black hair gleams with three flower bassinets. They said this brother was Charlie Abrines, the jazz man. The jazz man from Stockton. Blowing sax and piano. Yeah, man. What a rare move. I'm in. And it's almost like falling in love. Jazz of my youth. I was running Fillmore, the cool streets, talking deep and sweet with the sweet ladies. Yeah. I remember you, Fillmore. You're the one. Yeah, you're the one that made my dreams. Yeah, you're the one that made my dreams come true.
Recordings are forever. Oh!
I have lived in the Manila towns, Chinatown, in the J towns, in the black ghetto of Box City Dreams, and the soul-filled loneliness of Fillmore Street, crying in the blues. In Fox City, listening to Love Is Funny or Sad, but beautiful and wonderful. I knew every black, brown, yellow, red face in the street, and sometimes my mind is black. And sometimes my heart is Chicano. And sometimes my heart is black and Chicano at the same time. And sometimes my mind is black, and sometimes my mind is Chicano, and black and Chicano at the same time. Sometimes my belly is black, and sometimes my belly is Chicano. Sometimes my belly is black and Chicano at the same time. Sometimes my belly embraces all things, swallowing black, brown, yellow, red, belching up poems. Sometimes I feel like a crazy water buffalo, my tail wind-snapping in the four corners. Sometimes I feel like a crazy, drunken water buffalo in the wind.
Thank you. And I told them to keep feeding the birds and
other again and smiled and said, "Son, we're on America's side. Come, tell us, where did you come from?" So I looked at them and I said, "I clean toilets." And they got so angry at me, they called me all kinds of names. They wanted to find out exactly where I came from. They started to give me some crumbs, and they wanted me to open my mouth and tell them about everything. So I kept on telling that I was against America, and they got so angry at me and said, "Why did you go back where you came from?" I just sat there looking at the trees and the birds, and they just kept on yapping away, louder and louder. "Why don't you go back where you came from?" I told them, "I jumped out of my mama's womb, and goddamn, if I could jump back in there right now, I would." And they got so angry at me and threw the crumbs right in my face, and I laughed so hard, my belly ached. And I knew it was a warm summer day. It was a warm summer day, and I had to be on my way. Thank you.
And what he taught us, how to be a Filipino. Voltaire's idealized father figure, and mine too, I suppose. He was this Pinoy poet from Watsonville with the sleepy, wise face of a water buffalo, a man totally obsessed with the Philippines who'd never been there. In hushed tones, he described the fiery sunset, swaying coconut trees and white sand beaches, sounding like some romantic tourist brochure. Kinda ironic and laughable, except the kids thought it was funny too. "Oh yeah, sister, I forgot. I've never been there." America was here, vast, inhospitable, and harsh. The Philippines was there, distant, lush, soulful, and sexy. He made constant jokes out of what he called his Carabao dreaming, and wrote a series of self-deprecating haikus called Existential Pinoy Paralysis, questioning his fears about returning to the homeland. "Maybe I just don't want to be disappointed," went one of the more quotable lines in his poem, Maybe. Another ditty was called Expat versus Exile. The fact that Voltaire and I had actually been born in the Philippines earned us his lasting admiration. It was 1973. "Hoy, sister," he calls out when I stroll past Manong Joey's Kayumanguit Barbershop on Kearney Street. I'm on my way to see what I can shoplift at City Life Books, but I can't ignore that loud and insistent Filipino greeting. "What the fuck?" I mutter, annoyed. I stick my head into the dark, tiny storefront. Old Filipino men glare back at me from their pomade-scented gloom, even in their humble circumstance and advanced age. They exude gangster flash and style, chewing on fat cigars while they wait for their haircuts. Acting like millionaires and preening like peacocks, they wear pimpy suits with rakish fedoras or slouchy Panama hats of the softest weave and two-tone wingtips or white patent leather loafers on their feet. Manong Joey is in the midst of putting the finishing touches on some aging used-to-be gigolo's modified pompadour. The beat-up radios turn to K-Jazz. In this bastion of macho vanity and glamour, the Carabao Kid stands out in his chinos and muddy work boots, his graying hair pulled back in a loose ponytail, his goatee wispy. He's right at home, claiming one of Manong Joey's unused barber chairs and swapping tails with a Manong. They are obviously very fond of him. K Kid and the old guys could blah blah all day and all night. Talk story, the kid used to call it. He gently chides me for once describing myself as Filipino. Don't say Fili, sister. Say Fili. In Tagalog, Fili means to choose. Pino means fine. Filipino equals fine choice. I am impressed by his logic at first. Then I say, but Filipino and Filipino is not so different. Part of it's still a Spanish word. The Carabao Kid's heavy eyelids flutter, and he seems taken aback. Huh? He even grunts Filipino. Ha? Instead of ha. Fino, I repeat. Isn't that simply a twist on the Spanish word fino? The Carabao Kid is annoyed and amused. So, what you saying, sister? The Spaniards actually meant to call us Filipinos? Thank you.
Who killed the bird that mocked at the bamboo of her man. And Gabriella DeLong of yesterday and today. The true revolutionary, a real live woman warrior before Kingston made it fiction. But Molly is more than a teacher.
Since I was a child, I've been fascinated by the moon, even though I have never been there. Sobriety doesn't allow me to speak. Some feel that nostalgia is a treasure, and some feel it's the curse of romance. Your memory paints the walls of my cave, these photographs which terrify and inspire. Often, I stare long at your happiness and feel like crying. Whatever. And so, twilight here in my rumination allows me to rest. And even then, you are in my imagination, drifting like a child lying next to me, forgetting the world to savor the promises of your dreamland. I wonder where your midnight leads you. Perhaps huddled in your dim room, silent with your hair rustling against your pillow, that crown of placid auburn fire. Perhaps you swim, lonely as the soul, through telephone wires in search of company. Maybe you think of me and read the chapters I've written about you. It's annoying to recall how you think your poetry is trivial, you yourself being the poetry of forgotten life. Sometimes I forget the lyrics of Simple Blessings. I know that I want to kiss you before I die. Maybe nothing else. Maybe angels chose your name, a symbol of the sunrise. Maybe I'm just infatuated with an image. Or maybe love is much more than some short story I was forced to skim through in my youth. So let me tell you about solitude. This poem already feels like a sad cliche, speck of dust in the midnight sea and island. And yet, I remember the warmth of our fingertips. Somewhere, beyond tombstones and the evening sky, I think of the greetings in your voice calling upon me to live, even if only for an hour longer. You know, resting here is like temporary death. But even then, there is beauty. Your face shows itself in every flicker of light, and I swear I feel your hands holding me from the wind. And so I think to myself, only can I live in this place. I write the climax of a fictional play every hour I stay here. In the most popular version, the mangled golden ripeness of our souls dissolves into candle flames, into silhouettes of caramel torsos.
I say that I repeat your face to the ivory canyons of the moon and celebrate the sweet light of your echo. And so, buried beneath the lyrics of these dreams, I am here, as always, with the silent sacredness of your photographs and memories of a forgotten dance. Thank you.
My people, my musical, happy-go-lucky people, my adversity-enduring, still coming up smiling Filipino people. Focus on my Philippines, focus on my rich, fertile land that can grow tulips and roses for your lover, exploitable forever until the richness is gone. Focus on my Philippines. Focus on my workers, my dexterous female hands who submit to forced quotas and complaining machines, cheap, docile mass producers. Focus on my Philippines. Focus on my economy, my developing baby tiger. Thanks to your corporations, my privatization, my deregulation, liberalization, my human rights violations. Philippines. Focus on my Philippines, my democratic government that I learned from you, my free everything, basta kano. You're free to imperialize, to colonize. Focus on my Philippines. Take all my land, take my people, rape my workers, rape my country. Focus on my Philippines. Focus on my Philippines for free.
Once upon a time, you cursed the dusty ceiling, lying on a stranger's dining table to give birth to my mother during World War II. Your shrieks shaming the top of the heads of those crouched on the floor around you who thought Japanese soldiers were coming. The fighting would seem to be over, but your American battle was just beginning and would last for decades. Every weekend dawned as I woke to your commandments, starting with, "Thou shalt not sleep in." And every weeknight as I rested my young arguing voice and lips that cursed at not having watched TV because of homework, I wished I was born into an American family. Then you'd only use me to define boy crazy. You had high expectations of me to shadow my mother. But each rule you leaned your children on, which was swallowed with each teardrop, or impressed as a wrinkle in between her eyebrows, I casually flicked away with each adolescent sigh or roll of the eye. I was a rebel among the cousins. At family reunions, while everybody's mouth was stuffed with food and laughter, my mouth, so quietly, dropped its foot open during Tatai's slideshow at family reunions, where he displayed shots of him posing with his wife's girlfriend. I always wondered if he made you take those pictures, or how he held the camera, with a 5-year-old on your hip, an 8-year-old holding your hand, and 3 others jumping or probing around. Or maybe you were still on your way from Tungusanan, Philippines, to follow him all the way to Indiana, America. The only answers I got in response to my questions were a frowning shh and a kick under the table. Years later, I would find a narration of your struggle in between concrete walls, my eyes darting from the left to the right of expensive page for one expensive semester to learn something already in my memory. I watch you now in your wheelchair, unable to speak or walk because of some unclean mess in your brain. It's so against your style.
but I've still seen you as a widow who exercises at 7 o'clock every morning, cooks the best pinto in Michoacán, loves to gamble in Vegas, and parties with her 3 other widow friends, Alma Tata and all tough. You are the one who perfectly balances family obligation and personal gratification with dignified humility and graceful persistence. Now, the shishing have turned to drawn-out discussions and arguments covering everything, and the kicks are directed to the leg right next to the foot kicking. Everybody has revisited the past. I look at you and listen to your silence. Your silence is your most powerful statement yet. Thank you. I ask you as the parting listener.
This is dedicated to all the lit kids in Echo Park. Gun. Where's your gun, stupid? Everybody's got one. For $10, I could get you one, too. My dad's got a gun. Does yours? He was a cop. I know, because he's got a gun. I still play with it sometimes. He was a cop, now he's a lawyer, except in America. Still, he can buy 100 guns if I ask him. I wish I had a gun when those cholos by MacArthur Park hit me with a pool cue in the face. I would have shot, even though Mahatma Gandhi is my hero, and Martin Luther King, too. Nobody fucks with a gun. It could save all the babies and the children and the women and the new kid from the Philippines, the one everybody made fun of because he's still giving you bell bottoms in polyester. When anybody can tell you it's all about 501s, been for a whole year already, you fucking FOB. Where's your gun, stupid? We're coming to kill you. We're coming. Better run or get a gun if you want to hang. Can't hang without a gun. Where's your gun, stupid? Stupid, get your gun. Stupid, gun.
You who wanted to be a doctor, butchered, battered, beaten, stripped naked, centered, legs apart. You who were waiting to be asked to their first dance, cornered, fondled, scored, thrown across the table, mutilated. You with children learning their first words, picked on, kicked, slapped by men with guns in green uniforms. Kura! 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 You who were promised factory jobs, called in boats, shipped out to new countries, to stations full of men. Keep no height, no stopping. You nail height, no resting. Yano height, just pumping. Kitano height, performing. Homa height, moaning rhythms that go on and on and on and on. Here and now, each face, each black eye, each green uniform, each groan, nudge, suck, and shiver must come forth. No room here for shame or decency. There are 49 years of evidence to be prepared.
This piece is called, So You Call Yourself a Revolutionary. And this is dedicated to you special folks. So, you call yourself a revolutionary, or does the term vary for those who do or don't wish to carry the weight? Let's redefine your progressive mind state. Cause there's nothing more I hate than all talk, and no action. Revolution ain't fashion. It's strictly reserved for individuals with passion, which in our population is a minute fraction. People of dying while you on a sofa relaxing, asking, why ain't gotta be like that? When what you ought to be doing is purchasing yourself a gas. Put yourself in combat and go rat-a-tat-tat. So when you throw your guns in the air, you buck-buck because you care. Rhetoric will get you nowhere. Quit bitching about how life ain't fair and dare to bear your arms and fight. Exterminate the white. Lies that lie within your thinking. Get your third eye blinking. Will turning, burning inside. Words only provide a guide. But ultimately can't stop the penetration of an enemy sword or bullet or penis raping, violating, taking what's yours. Capitalist laws, civil wars, and sex tools. And you still believe that yapping your jaws for the cause will get the bullshit to pause? Well, if words are your primary tool for revolution, then years ago we would have had a solution. Because the number of us using words is a high percentage, mostly for an image. Because ain't nobody down to pass the line of scrimmage. Which in turn creates a limit when revolutionary ideas should be infinite. Now take a look at yourselves for a minute. Are you a revolutionary? Because you got big ideas and a fancy vocabulary. Talking about by any means necessary. Obviously taking words out of text. What's next? Start dressing like a Black Panther, slash tribal chief, nickling dancer. With no fucking answer. Or as the hardest spoken word artist, poetry reading, having folks believing in a struggle you ain't even been through. I must be a revolutionary too. Cause I ain't done shit just like you. Hiding place, cause I'm scared to face the fact, the reality, the truth, that words ain't bulletproof. So, isn't that scary? And you call yourself a revolutionary? My name is Keaton.
Promising thee success and freedom, you want some these things make an educated incision and you'll see you're just like an heir, so make the decision to find liberation in something else, your mind, your words, the front line. Because although we all seem fine, a spirit can be broken without breaking the skin and spine. Confusion. Mass confusion. Worldwide disillusion. The solution, in conclusion, mass inclusion, revolution, peace.
Mine called in response to the woman who asked, how many generations does it take to take Asian Pacific American women? How many generations does it take to erase ethnic specification, cultural identification with an other nation from your sight and sensation? 10 years seems to be a good round number to tear our sense of identity asunder, where Western civilization has yet to loot and plunder, making us culturally dumb and dumber. In our mind's eyes, they've taken away our prized possession, our sole consolation in a nation that thrives in identity degeneration, bland expectations, and covert racist citations. How many generations does it take to forget those who we should thank for creation? Does it take to birth a homogeneous nation? Does it take for assimilation? To adhere to a thought process that's all messed up, it's all a big set up. It's all time for us to get up and walk away from the man who holds the corrosive plan. Time to take a stand, to get up and find our own promised land. Thriving on a world controlled by mass media, seen as believing all you hear and read, thoughts become superseded by greed and the need to feed a growing capitalist seed, growing the people who surround us. How many generations does it take to become civilized, to have centuries of brainwashing finally be realized, white Anglo-Saxon Protestants mesmerized, America can history memorize? How many generations, gendered Asians, how much generalized frustration in our generations that is left do we have to lay station to subculture, subhuman, below, beneath, bottom, forsaken, pacification? Will we allow America to degrade the Black, Latino, and Asian, blind our other reality, refusing to see the other identity that they have forced us to be is now important to the we that we have created for our collective sanity? Don't claim our question, the question is irrelevant, to stabilize your fear, trivialize my existence that faces your ignorance. Give knowledge a chance instead of expecting me to shut up and dance. So how many generations does it take to cut ties with our cultural nationalist identification so that we too can live in bland American stagnation of a red, white, and blue hill figure creation, accepting of a political marginalization, hunger for assimilation, only to be of American specification, that solely lives in a deluded foreign imagination? How many generations will it take our brothers and sisters in our Filipino nation to come to the realization that we are struggling against some racist and sexist education, patriarchal gendered relations, little brown brothers, and mail order infatuation? There is no amount of time, no approximate deadline, no punishment for already committed crimes, no indication of the demise of a mindset that is too deeply embedded in the American mentality. I regret, because our story won't let me forget.
Thank you.
feel like Helen. My, you sure look good tonight, lotion. Potent potions spurting from the hand that rocks the bop pile. I'm docile, we're hostile. Together creating this emotional profile of a madman and woman hand in hand. Manifesting the extreme. The cookie versus the cream. Just one or the other, O-E-O, so it may seem. Like feeling like this and like that and like this and knowing it all too well in your dreams. Dream on, dream away, why do I feel real? Day after day, time after time, being charged for killing this crime. Convicted of conviction, creating conflict, affliction of the soul. Somewhat humble, somewhat whole in my heart in my whole being. Like seeing the demons from within and consuming the angelic embraces, many faces, traces of a schizophrenic psyche, psycho, starting to click together. All that one is bodies interacting, arousing, thinking of thoughts and emotions.
And all of our friends,
can never put together the feelings we have.
This is dedicated to my grandmother who just passed, and through her struggle and resistance, showed me what it means to be a Filipino. She always be proud of that. Big City. Lunchtime at Ling Nam. Can you see me? Bleeding fluid before you. Walking tall and bright. I enter sitting order. Yes, ma'am, I know what a doughboy is. I know how to cook it. Feeling the eyes and listening to the dissenting murmurs of those whose lips I do not fit onto, into, or around to. You, I wish to slap, to shout, to wake the fuck up. For you're the one who holds a foolish view of traits I could never have or buy. Try as I might fit your trip in listening to your mama's calling for one who's flipping out. As I flounder about without the beauty of a brother or sister to whom I would say, hold my hand, let us plan, or even disagree. Guide and follow me to a space where our voices are unbounded and bouncy, smacking and singing with respectful ears, painful tears, yearning for the movies of an ignorant man, woman, and child, miles to extreme, in their dreams to this blissfully unsilent. Minus the violence of categorical, rhetorical needs to fit properly into that tiny space where in actuality nobody can belong to, where everybody wishes to exclude from the outside, the silly love for the desired other, another I cannot be.
One thing we didn't do is recognize the musicians. So. We all have the following collective in the Filipino Studies Conference wants to recognize Theo Gonzalez and Hannah. Again, Wendell's going to have some last words, but I wanted to say welcome to the conference and have a great time in LA. Thank you.
I can't believe everyone's still here. I mean, this goes to show that we need to maintain and create more spaces to where identities and expressions can grow. Plain and simple, man, they got to chase those crazy bald heads out of town. So, the books are there, because they're infinite, and Manam Al and, Jessica are going to be signing, so please support, because, we can, and, live and love life, give thanks and praises. Batala, yes.
One last time for all the performers, and we out.